So just keep in mind that here the problem that the low-cost firm has incentive to mimic high-cost firm, to pretend to be high-cost with this kind of full information scheme. That will be important later. So now, how to deal with asymmetric information? So you have some constraint. The constraint is that firm participate, and you will induce truthful revelation of type, of cost type. How you can capture those constraints? So with some constraint to the maximization, or minimization program. Okay, so the objective of the regulator is to minimize damage plus transfer, plus subsidies. Because remember, the regulator has to pay for the cost of abatement through the subsidy. So this is the objective. Now the mechanism, which is defined by some emission and transfer depending on type, contingent on type. Again, the idea is to have emission and subsidy for each type and make sure that each type selects the one which is devoted to, focused on itself. The schemes must be such that all the both type of firm agree, participate. So these are what is called the participation constraint or individual rationality constraint. So these are the two first set of constraints. So the transfer should at least cover the cost for each type. And then you have the second constraint, which is more tricky, which makes sure that each type of firm picks the transfer emission that is assigned to itself. Okay. So reveal its own type by selecting the right abatement or emission and subsidy. Why is it the case? Because of that. So let's write down here. So if, let's consider a low cost firm, if the low-cost firm pretend to be low cost, or tell the truth, or select the emission and subsidy for low cost, it will have to pay for the cost. It will have to incur the cost of low cost with the emission for low cost firm. This will be the cost, and it will receive this transfer. If it lies, that is, it selects the emission and subsidy which is assigned for high cost, it will get the transfer for high cost. It will have to emit the high cost level, but it is of low cost. So the incentive compatibility constraint tells you that the payoff of the firm is higher by telling the truth than by lying. So this is for the low-cost firm, and for the high-cost firm is the reverse. The high-cost firm has also some incentive compatibility constraint. And you want to make sure that it prefers to tell the truth rather than lying, pretending to be low-cost, emitted low-cost, and even if costs are high. Okay. So you have two incentive compatibility constraints. Now, how to solve this problem? The simplest way to solve the problem is try to figure out which constraints are binding. And to try to get the binding constraint, you compare to the full information case. What are the incentives? So we say that the incentive was... What was the incentive? The incentive was that the low-cost firm will pretend to be high-cost. Why? Because, as I said, as a regulator, you want to have some efficient emission level. So you know if the cost of the firm is high, you will ask for more emission, that is, less abatement. So by pretending to be high, you will have to abate less, and also you will be reimbursed. The subsidy will cover for the high cost firm, so you will get the return which is higher,
which is based for high cost. So you get some rent for out of that. So the incentive is here. What is the problem is here, that the low-cost firm will prefer to be there. So that will mean that this is, will be the binding constraint. So the binding incentive policy constraint will be this one. So what you do to solve, you bind this constraint. And then there is another binding constraint, which is which one? Yeah, individual rationality for high cost. Because the high cost firm is high cost firm is higher by definition, and therefore you want to minimize transfer, and you minimize transfer by paying the high cost firm. So the two constraints, binding constraints, will be those two. So if you bind those two constraints, then you can substitute the transfer, the high cost here. And then what you get the transfer for the low cost, which is what? So the low cost will be pay its own cost plus this term. And this term is called the informational rent. This is a rent the low-cost firm get by due to asymmetric information. Because there is asymmetric information, you need to provide a bonus for the more efficient firm in order to be sure that this firm selects the right contract, the right regulation. So this is positive. Here you can see, for the same level of emission, the cost is higher here than here, therefore this amount is positive for any level of emission. Okay? So you have to pay more than what you would like to pay due to asymmetry information. Okay, so this is how you solve it. You bind the binding constraint. So you can define So you can define delta I label delta E the informational rent, that is the difference of cost from high cost, low cost for any level of emission. And then you substitute the transfer into the objective function. So when you do that, you end up with a simplified problem. Okay. So you have the damage plus the cost plus the informational rent. This is for the low cost, probability nu. And you have the damage plus the cost you have to pay because you have to subsidize the cost for the high cost, with probability 1 minus mu. Because with probability 1 minus mu, the firm is of high cost. To get the solution, you take the derivative, you equalize to 0, and you get the following first order condition. Okay? What does it tell you? First one tells you that you equalize marginal damage to marginal abatement cost for the low-cost firm. It means that emission for the low-cost is first best. This is something which is called in mechanism design no distortion at the top. For the more efficient firm, you have no distortion. For the less efficient, then you have a distortion. You equalize the marginal damage to the marginal cost, abatement cost, plus this term. Why? Why do you have this term? Because you want to minimize the informational rent you have to pay for the low-cost firm. So here you solve a trade-off. You want to have something efficient, but on the other hand, you want to minimize the subsidy. Well, therefore, you do some distortion to minimize the subsidy. So it turned out that this term is positive, I think. Anyway, so it turned out that you distort emission, that is, the emission you ask to the high-cost firm is higher than the first best. There is over-emission compared to the first best. This is to minimize the informational rent. The trick here that you want to minimize, you distort emission for the high-cost firm to minimize informational rent to the low-cost firm. Okay. because the rent is paid for the low cost. And at the end, you get the transfer. So I label by SB for second best. This is the second best policy. The best you can do in given that there is a symmetric formation. The first best is the best you can do under full information. Second best is the best you can do under asymmetric information. So then you the transfer is, as I say, you pay the cost for the low cost plus some rent, which is minimized because you have distorted emission. And you just pay the cost for the high cost. So this is the best you can do here. Now, so here I gave you the mathematical derivation, and also I've tried to get you a little bit of the intuition, economic intuition. Let me have some graphical interpretation. In order to have graphical interpretation, I've plot here the indifference curves. This is for the regulator. So here, this is indifference curves, and there are two decisions for the regulator point of view, and how much to emit, how much to let the firm emitting, and what will be the subsidy, the transfer to the firm, how much to pay to the firm. And these are, so the regulator is indifferent along this line among these two, emission and transfer. But of course, you know the regulator would like to reduce emission and reduce subsidies. That means that the welfare of the regulator is higher when you move from this line to this one. The lower is the transfer, the lower is emission, the higher is the welfare. Or the lower is the social damage due to emission and and the subsidy. So these are the difference curve with a higher social welfare for the regulator. What about the firm? And you can check that it has this shape also. What about the firm? This is the indifference curve of the firm. So the firm also likes subsidy. The regulator dislikes subsidies, but the firm likes subsidies to get money. And what? So it's the profit, the profit function. So these are indifference curves, and these are the two different levels of profit. This is a higher level compared to this one, compared to this one. Here you get more emission and more subsidies compared to this one and this one. And this tells you how much you are, as a definition for indifference curves, it tells you how much you are as a firm, you will accept to give up in terms of subsidy to emit more. Or reversely, how much you will accept to abate against some subsidies. When you move along this line, so for instance, you are indifferent between this level of abatement and the subsidy with this level of abatement and the subsidy. Okay. And this is for the low cost, so with this particular slope. Now for the high cost, the slope is higher. Because for the same level of abatement, you will have more subsidy. So you accept to reduce emission by one unit with a higher subsidy compared to the low cost. Okay. So the slope are different. Now in this framework, in this graph, this is the first best. Remember, the first best is where the marginal damage equal to the marginal abatement cost. That means that the two indifference curves, the indifference curves of the regulator and the indifference curves of the firm, are tangent. So these emissions are tangent. Okay. First point. Second point, in the first best, under full information, the regulator just reimburses the cost, pays the cost. Therefore, the subsidy is just the cost. And therefore, the difference curves here is where the profit is equal to zero for both type of firm. Okay. So this is the first best. It tells you that the low-cost firm should emit this, and it gets a transfer equal to the cost, and the high-cost firm should emit more, And here, but it could be different, the right golfer gets a higher subsidy. But it could be a lower also, depending on the parameters. Now, as I told you that, as you can see here, it cannot be implemented under asymmetric information. Why? Because the low-cost firm will pretend to be high-cost. So the story as follows. You have the choice. You can emit this level and you get this transfer, or emit more and you get more transfer. Of course, you want to emit more. You can see that here in this picture, because if you plot the indifference curves of the low cost, by picking this contract, the low cost moves to a higher indifference curve. Okay? The indifference curves are higher when you move upward for the firm. Okay. Now, what can you do? So you have to move these 2 points in a way that the low-cost firm is indifferent between this contract and this one. So to be indifferent, the two contracts should be on the same indifferent curve. That means that the constraint is binding. Okay, so what you will do, you will move a little bit this upward. This is the idea of having some informational rent. You increase the subsidy by moving upward, but you will not change the emission. You still get the first best. And then you move a little bit this one, but you move it a little bit on this direction. That is, you allow more emission for the high-cost firm. So you move these 2 points to get them in the same indifference curve. So here, this is a problem that the firm type, the low-cost firm is in a higher indifference curve if it pretends to be of high cost. So this is what you do. You modify the contract. This is a contract for the low-cost firm, and this is the one which is devoted to the high cost. Okay, so you can see that the low-cost firm is indifferent between these two contracts, because these two contracts, you know, these two contract regulation are in the same indifference curve. There is some rent. The rent is the distance between the two indifference curves. And there is some distortion here. How you can see there is a distortion? Because in this point, the indifference curve the indifference curve of the regulator is not tangent to the indifference curve of the firm. That's when you don't equalize marginal damage to marginal cost. But here you are sure that everything is incentive compatible, and they participate because they get both non-negative payoff profit from participating. Okay, you can see here also that what you have done also, you have moved the contract for the high-cost firm from here to here. That means the high-cost firm is on the same indifference curve, is indifferent between this and this. So this is because this is binding still. Okay, so this is the kind of constraint you get. Of course, this is very simple because you have only two types. So you can be of L or H, but in reality, you can have like a continuum of types. And the model generates for continuum of types. But the intuition is the same. If you have a continuum of type, you have no distortion at the top. For the more efficient firm, there's no distortion. For the less efficient firm in the range of type, there is no rent. All the other firms will get some rent, and there will be distortion for all firms except the one at the top. So you have the same kind of result with a continuum of types for the same reason. But the math is a little bit more complex. You have to make some integral and integral by part and so on. It's a bit heavy. So what I would like you to get out of this second part of the lecture is really the intuition of having a second best mechanism. Now this is the best you can do with a direct revelation mechanism. Now there is several ways to implement this mechanism with real world regulations. So it could be that you can, for instance, set a standard. So you set a standard for the high cost corresponding to the high cost firm. So you say, okay, you are not allowed to emit more than this level, the second best level for the high cost firm, and you get an extra subsidy if you abate more, if you emit even less. And the subsidy will be the informational rent. This is one way to implement this regulation. For instance, it could be without paying the cost, but then you will get something which is closer than, which is more efficient, which will be the second best emission level. And this is what Mason and Plantinga have done, basically in their paper. They have designed the second best regulation. And then what they have done, which is interesting, they have estimated the second best regulation with the data from the US. So they have, if you have a look on their paper, what you can find is that they have computed the informational rent that you have to pay for farmer, and it depends on their own type. So here there is a continuum of theta, not only two, but a continuum. And they have designed the second best mechanism, the second best transfer and second best share of land, which is preserved by, which is devoted to forest. And empirically, they have compared this regulation with a flat subsidy. Okay. So the regulation is there are different share of land that you can devote to forest, in which you can preserve forest, and the payment depends on this share of land. This is the second mechanism. A simple mechanism will be just to pay a fixed subsidy for each acre of land which is preserved in terms of forest. So they compare the second best mechanism with this third best mechanism, and they try to assess what are the efficiency gain of having this second best mechanism. And they've done that for a benefit of $100 per acre of forest preserved. And if for this benefit, they estimated that using a second best scheme, they can increase the forest area in the US by 61 million acres at annual cost of $4.36 billion, which has to be compared to the amount of you will have to pay with a subsidy which is more than twice. So you can save on the subsidy by having a more complex second best regulation compared to a flat subsidy to preserve these 61 million of acres of forest in the US. That will be the one. What we will do, you will do if the benefit was for $100 per acre. Okay, so let me summarize what we've done today. The aim of this lecture is to try to analyze policy instruments when you have asymmetric information about abatement cost. Type of asymmetric information we were considering is adverse selection. Firms are born with some abatement cost, which is asymmetric, known only by the firm itself, or firm has a better knowledge of own abatement cost compared to the regulator. That's the main idea. We can consider other asymmetric information problems like emission or noise observed, or I don't know. But we're focused mostly on this one, or exclusively on this one. First, we have analyzed the choice between an emission fee or a cap, and then we went through some well-known result by Martin Weizmann, which tells you that the choice between the fee and the cap depends on the relative slope of marginal abatement cost versus marginal damage. If the marginal damage are more deeply sloped than marginal abatement cost, then you should go for an emission cap. And the reverse, if you do, in the reverse case, you should go for a fee. Then we move to the more, we consider the case of contract-based regulation, and we move to more recent mechanism design to try to compute the best contract-based regulation we can imagine. Given the constraint that we face to asymmetric information on abatement cost. So what you will do, you will design a menu of transfer contingent on abatement levels that firms are free to pick, such that they will pick the one that are assigned to for different type of firms, and the firm will reveal their type by picking the abatement level and the transfer that correspond to their own type. So you will have true full revelation of type. And with this kind of mechanism, you will subsidize more abatement and you will distort abatement for high cost. So there is distort abatement for high cost and informational range for low cost, for more efficient firms. And the reason is that you want to trade off efficiency versus paying a subsidy for the firm. So to minimize the subsidy you have to pay the firm, you do some you distort abatement or emissions. In general, no, they are not equal. The thing is, if you had first best abatement for the high cost, the rent will be higher. So the low cost firm will get a higher rent. So you reduce this rent by making some distortion, by distorting abatement for the high cost. But still the high cost get no rent at all. Okay. So that's... So what we have done today, we are working a model with emissions instead of abatement, you can do the same story with a model with only abatement. So instead of having emission and damage due to emission, you get benefit of abatement and abatement cost, not cost from reducing emission. And And this is the exercise I've prepared for you. So it's a quite technical course. In order to integrate this course, you have to train a little bit. If you want to learn how to bike, you have to go into the bike. It's not like by watching the bike that you can learn how to bike. So I gave you a couple of problems.